Okay, well, let's get going then this morning. Welcome, everybody. Hope everybody's doing well and not going stir crazy from being locked up in your houses for the last number of weeks. Looks like we're in for a little bit longer of that stuff going on around here. So today we're going to talk about autoimmune disorders. And it says histology, but we'll obviously talk about some clinical stuff also. So what are the autoimmune connective tissue disorders? Well, you guys know what this is in general, but basically it's where the host's immunity is directed to itself. Generally synonymous with collagen vascular diseases, but a lot of people sort of throw these autoinflammatory disorders in. I'll talk a little bit about that at the end, but won't spend a lot of time on that. They can be associated with antibodies, complement products. Vasculitis is often included in here. We're going to have a separate talk on that later in the week. And then we'll talk about some of the clinical information. Even though they're called collagen vascular, a lot of times neither the collagen nor the blood vessels are involved. So these are the general diseases included in this spectrum of things, and we'll go through a lot of these today, with the exception of vasculitis. So let's start off with the sclerosing disorders, and these all have in common sclerosis of collagen. So you need to know what that is under the microscope. Basically, it's homogenization of the collagen with a decrease in the number of fibroblasts versus an increase in the number of fibroblasts, which is what we see with fibroplasia, with fibrosis. And so we have several of these diseases listed here, scleroderma, amorphia, eosinophilic fasciitis, LSNA, chronic radiation dermatitis. We're going to go through some of these. Scleroderma, which is just kind of a generic term, sort of includes all this stuff together. If you look at the rheumatologist, obviously they break things out into progressive systemic sclerosis and CREST and whatnot, but you can just kind of have a general family of disease if you want to just call them all scleroderma. Usually we get on the face and the hands, hardening and tightening the skin, and some of the earliest manifestations may be that patients just complain they can't close their hands as easily as they could. And when you biopsy lesions with that, the so-called puffy phase of scleroderma or amorphia involving the acral areas, you'll see mostly involvement of the septa of the subcutaneous fat with some edema, maybe a little bit of early sclerosis. These often will have a positive ANA with the SCL70, anti-centromere, of course, with morphia and CREST. So again, these are some clinical photos, the acrosclerosis, the pinched facies. This lady over here probably has got some CREST with some telangiectasia there. And then the inverse pterygium of the fingers. They lose the substance under their fingernails here. That's a pretty classic manifestation of acrosclerosis. These are some of the mat-like telangiectasia that you see with CREST. And the calcinosis that you see with CREST. Also, you notice she's got that pterygium unguem inversus here as well. Now, amorphia, here basically lesions limited to the skin and the subcutaneous fat. There's six general types. We'll kind of look at some of those. Plaque type is probably the most common. And to get these early on, they can kind of have more of a violaceous color to them. You can get linear amorphia, you can generalize amorphia. So these are some, this kind of an early lesion. And we see a lot of these sometimes submitted to us as rule out mycosis fungoides. And you can see why. It's a somewhat pinkish lesion, violaceous lesion on the trunk, which is a classic location. Early on, they may not have a lot of firmness to them. So sometimes can be confused with MF, usually not scaly though, but there sometimes be LSNA and morphia together where there can be some scale. Linear morphia. And notice the difference in the size of the child's leg here. It causes atrophy of the underlying bone and muscles when you get that. The Perry-Romberg sign, the coup de sabre manifestation here. So these are just different. They're all, if you biopsy these, they all look the same. And then pansclerotic morphia. They can actually get into situations with obstructive lung disease. They can't breathe because their chest wall becomes so thickened and sclerotic with the collagen that they can't move their air as much. You can also get morphia with the confetti-like pigmentation. And if you look at the biopsy of these little small areas, they look just like vitiligo. So they actually are depigmented in these lesions. It's probably not really vitiligo, but they actually do get a confetti-like depigmentation that you can see with morphia. So if you look at it early, that's the best time to get the diagnosis. You can get a moderate to relatively dense infiltrate that can be both perivascular but also interstitial. So morphea, scleroderma is one of the diseases in the inflammatory states and give you the interstitial mostly pattern. And it can consist of lymphocytes, plasma cells, and sometimes you get actually quite a few eosinophils. A lot of people don't realize that. And you can see that with morphea or scleroderma or with the eosinophilic fasciitis. And then you get the thickened collagen bundles. They usually occur, actually, interestingly enough, in the lower part of the dermis first. They kind of move to the upper part of the dermis. The fat eventually gets replaced by sclerotic collagen. And then later on, you get just this dense, diffuse sclerosis with no inflammation. You lose the pigment in the epidermis again. So here's a nice example, low magnification. You can see it's got that so-called square morphology that we see because of the sclerotic collagen. And this one also has got the, notice that the septa are markedly thickened here. So that's the earliest manifestation, is septal edema within sclerosis and then progressing to the sclerotic collagen. And you get these lymphoplasmacytic aggregates, often right at the periphery of the thick collagen bundles of the dermis and the subcutaneous fat. Very characteristic of a relatively early inflammatory lesion morphia. Here's another example, pretty diffuse sclerosis. Notice that there's a marked decrease in the number of fibroblasts here. And these collagen bundles are like leather. They're markedly thickened, they're homogenized, and there's a striking decrease in the number of fibroblasts. These are lymphocytes and also plasma cells here. And we may even see some eosinophils. Here, you see those lymphoplasmacytic aggregates here that we saw at low magnification. So again, if you see that, that's pretty classic for morphea or scleroderma or any of those diseases. They all look the same. So it's kind of an end-stage reaction pattern. It's not, you can't just look at that and say, ah, that patient's gonna have lung disease, or that patient's got CREST, that patient's got an overlap syndrome. We just don't know when we look at the biopsy. So it's a dermal reaction pattern. Now, LSNA, again, this is basically, you can think of it kind of like morphea that's involving the papillary dermis only. So if it gets into the reticular dermis, then we think it's more, we think of it as morphea, and then morphea with features of LSNA. And early on here, you can get edema of the papillary dermis with thinning the epidermis. It can give you a thick cornified layer with follicular plugging and some extravasated red cells. You can get a blister. And the reason you get that thick epidermis, or the thick cornified layer, even with the thin epidermis, is that it's pruritic. So patients that you've seen in the clinic with LSNA, they complain of itching, especially when it occurs in the genital area. It's not confined to the genital area, especially when it's possibly associated with morphea, like in this situation. Notice here it's on the trunk. Okay, so this is not the genital type. This is more of a classic genital type of LSNA, often seen in young individuals, but seen in older people also. And here's an example. Notice this markedly sclerotic papillary dermis. Okay, so there's a decrease in the number of fibroblasts here in the papillary dermis. The reticular dermis beneath is normal. So this is pure LSNA. There's no morphea with LSNA here. This is totally 100% LSNA. And notice that the epidermis is very, very thin. There's a thick cornified layer. They've been rubbing it. And then there's this split here. And that's actually, notice there's some fluid in that space. So it's not purely a histologic artifact. This is a true blister. And LSNA is a disease that actually forms a blister because of this cohesion between the epidermis and the underlying sclerotic collagen. And you can get bullous LSNA. It often gives erythrocytes in the blister space. Okay, also, it's very characteristic. So thick cornified layer from rubbing, thin epidermis, sclerotic papillary dermis that gets edematous, like you see here. So it's a nice example of LSNA. And this is a bullous lesion of LSNA. So this is a real blister. Okay, it's a sub-epidermal. It's really almost in some cases a true intradermal blister, like we had that case last week of bullous amyloid. Well, here you get the actual sclerotic collagen is not normal, and it actually can just fall apart and actually form a blister. So here you see a little bit of that dermal collagen contiguous with the epidermis up here. So it's not always a sub-epidermal blister. And then the infiltrating LSNA, again, can be lymphocytes, can have some plasma cells in it. Usually you don't get too many eosinophils in LSNA. Now, a couple other conditions where you can get sclerotic collagen, but it's not really in the same family, if you will, of scleroderma and morphea. Chronic graft versus host disease. Patients years ago that took the toxic oil, they got toxic oil from the contaminated melatonin and some of the things and these toxic oil that was present in some of the our agricultural products were imported from Spain a few years ago. They can give you the same type of morphology. And here you see somebody that's got chronic GVH, scleroderma, like morphology, both clinically and histologically. You look under the microscope, it pretty much looks the same. So once again, you need to have clinical information. Chronic sclerodermoid PCT can also look like this. So again, this is a reaction pattern that you have to have clinical information, or you just basically call it scleroderma or sclerosing dermatitis. Now, eosinophilic fasciitis is in the same category. This, in order to make this diagnosis, you really need to take a deep incisional biopsy and you need to get into the fascia. There may be some sclerosis of the dermis. So if you just do a deep biopsy with a punch, for example, you don't get into the fascia. It may look like scleroderma, but actually it can be a deeper involvement. It can get all the way down into the muscle in some cases. Classically, clinically, you see these linear groove signs. They tend to follow the course of blood vessels, which are kind of running between the muscle groups. This can occur in several different settings. It also can be due to ingestion of certain toxins, but it often follows heavy exercise, often on the extremities. And you get this markedly thickened fascia with an inflammatory infiltrate of lymphocytes, plasma cells, and usually eosinophils. Now, the other thing is that you realize in eosinophilic fasciitis, you may not get too many eosinophils in the tissue, but there can be eosinophils that are circulating. But you usually do see eosinophils in the tissue. Eosinophilia myalgia, okay, we talked about this, the ingestion of L-tryptophan, the toxic oil from rapeseed oil. Again, it looks very similar to eosinophilic fasciitis. You can get this lesion actually ulcerate, reticularis, muscle weakness, et cetera. But histology looks pretty similar to eosinophilic fasciitis. So here's a good example of the clinical. You get these little grooves, it's almost kind of amoeboid appearance to the lesions clinically. Another example, you can see that groove right in this area here. And if you felt this, it feels woody, really, really dense sclerotic collagen. And this is a deep incisional biopsy. So we don't have any epidermis or dermis here. This is all fat and fascia. And notice how markedly thickened this is. Normally, your fascia is like this. It's very, very thin, little tiny wispy strands of collagen. But when they get markedly thickened like this, and sometimes they get really, really thick, like you see up here, that's a sign that you're dealing with a fasciitis. And in higher magnification, you can see that it's developing the same kind of sclerotic pattern. The number of fibroblasts is decreasing. The collagen bundles are increasing. They're homogenizing. And then you get this infiltrate in the periphery of this thing that's got lymphocytes. But this one does have lots of eosinophils in it. So this is a classic example of eosinophilic fasciitis. Okay, now this is not a sclerosing disorder, nephrogenic fibrosing dermopathy. This is actually a fibrosing disorder, and it's associated with gadolinium intake, usually in patients that have had chronic renal failure. They get a magnetic resonance angiogram, and they get the gadolinium. I'm not sure they're even giving much gadolinium today because of this process. And they get this markedly thickened skin on the trunk and extremities, and this thickness goes all the way down into the fat. It can go all the way down into the periosteum. So it really is markedly thickened. It affects large areas of the body, and it's really goes deep into the skin. So in order to get this diagnosis, you can take a punch biopsy and see it in the dermis. But if you want to see how deep it goes, sometimes they do imaging studies. They can demonstrate marked thickening of the septa, even involvement all the way down into the bone. You can get this markedly increase the number of the fibroblasts in the dermis. You get mucin sometimes. And you get these calcified little lollipop structures, which are really interesting. And this looks pretty similar to eosinophilic fasciitis clinically. Kind of get this diffuse sort of amoeboid sclerosing feel to the dermis here, usually on the extremities, maybe on the trunk also. All of these areas would feel very, very firm to palpation. And here's a biopsy, and notice again, there's involvement of the dermis and the fascia. This goes really, really deep. Notice how thick this fascia is, really, really markedly thickened here. And as we go to higher magnification, as opposed to the morphine scleroderma, where you see a decrease in the fibroblast, here you've got a marked increase in the number of these fibroblasts. So this is a fibrosing process, okay? Here's another example, and here we've got those little lollipop structures. And often you'll see some calcification in here. And if you look really carefully, In the center of these, you'll see these elastic fibers that are kind of brownish, slightly gray. And if you look at really high magnification, that's just a VDG to demonstrate that these are elastic fibers, you can actually see the little particles of gadolinium that are deposited on the elastic fibers. So even if you look out here, those are kind of grayish brown, and those are due to the gadolinium that deposits. So it's almost analogous in a way to argyria and some of these other metals that like to deposit on your elastic fibers and then result in secondary structures like this that develop. This is pathognomonic for this. So it's quite possible that they could show you something like this on the board. And if you see this, there's nothing else that does this. And sometimes you'll actually get calcinosis cutis associated with this as well. Shifting gears, scleromyxedema, papular myxinosis, lichen myxedematosis. This is kind of a family of disorders in which there's an increase again in spindle cells with mucin. And many of these, not all of them, are associated with a paraproteinemia. If you get this, you need to rule out an underlying paraproteinemia. Scleromyxedema refers to the widespread variant with markedly thickened skin, so it looks sclerotic. Papular myxinosis is the papular variant where you get multiple small 2 to 3 millimeter papules, face, trunk, neck, extremities, et cetera. And that's pretty much synonymous with lichen myxedematosis. And there are a couple of other variants, the acral persistent variant, the self-healing variant. So, but the thing is, if you see this diagnosis, you really want to make sure that you don't miss an underlying paraproteinemia. Scleromyxedema, they give you classically these leonine facies, lots of fibroblasts in the dermis. Later, you can get true fibrosis, and then mucin. More mucin in this than in lichen myxedematosis. You may actually get a decrease in the elastic fibers. So you should know the differential diagnosis of things that give you leonine facies, this, certain other lymphomas, acromegaly, you know, things of that nature. So know the disorders that can cause this, but this is definitely one of them. Another example, this lady didn't have leonine facies, but her skin was just so diffusely infiltrated by these fibroblasts in the mucin. Her skin looked like she had scleroderma. So it's called scleromyxedema. It looks sclerotic, feels sclerotic. Histologically, though, no sclerosis, but does have the myxedematous appearance, especially when you do the biopsy. If you look at this lesion over here, you see that basically what this is a sea of these tiny little papules that have coalesced to form this diffuse infiltration of her skin. Here's the biopsy. Low magnification, it almost looks like granulomedullary. It's got this perivascular and interstitial, almost palisaded appearance of these cells that look like histiocytes at low magnification. So this is one of the diseases, again, that gives you an interstitial pattern, like interstitial GA, but it's not GA. And at this power, you can see that these really aren't histiocytes. They're really fibroblasts, and some of them are histiocytes, but they're fibroblast histiocytes with lymphocytes. And notice that they're arranged in this kind of, they're not really in a palisade. It sort of looks like somebody sort of shot them out with a shotgun. They're sort of north, south, east, and west. They're going all different directions. So it's not just a classic palisade. It's almost like they're interstitially and diffusely present, but they're present mostly in the upper part of the reticular dermis. So here you see a high magnification. There may be, there is some mucin here in the background. It's kind of hard to appreciate, but there's mucin. And then there are all these cells in here that are fibroblasts and histiocytes, not just histiocytes like you see with GA. This is more of the papular mucinosis form. Again, you see all these little papules here that are coalescing over here in the gentleman's face and on the arms. And if you biopsy this, again, it shows these fibroblasts that are present diffusely. This one's got a little bit more interstitial mucin and a little bit more lymphocytes here, but it's basically the same process, just a different clinical manifestation of it. And if you do a special stain, this one shows the mucin better on the routine stain over here. And if you, this is a colloidal iron stain for mucin, and it's just loaded. It highlights all the mucin that you can see on the H&E over here, just makes it more obvious with the special stain. And then there's a variant called acral persistent papular mucinosis. It's a variant of the same process, but tends to be fewer lesions. They're acral. These patients often don't have an underlying paraproteinemia. They probably should be followed to make sure they don't develop that over the course of time. But notice that this one almost looks like a little area of just focal cutaneous mucinosis, but it's got a few more fibroblasts here in the stroma than you see with that. And the multiple little whitish papules, you should at least think of this diagnosis. Usually if you see just focal cutaneous mucinosis or cutaneous myxoma, there's one lesion. here you've got about, you know, a cluster of about 20 or 30 lesions here together. So you want to just make sure this isn't part of a more widespread systemic process. This chart shows you kind of a comparison and contrast between nephrogenic fibrosing dermopathy, morphea, scleroderma, and scleroderma myxedema. You can look at this on your own, but basically there is a way to tell these apart from one another. Usually histologically, it's not too terribly difficult to do. Okay, let's shift gears and talk about lupus. Obviously, there's a wide range of clinical manifestations of lupus, and you should know basically everything there is to know about lupus. You need to know the clinical manifestations, the criteria for systemic LE, make sure you know the ANA pattern, the profiles, double-strand DNA, Smith antibody, the various antibodies and types of patterns you see, centromere pattern, et cetera, and some of the other connective tissue diseases. So just make sure you're well aware of that. Clinical subtypes ranging from the acute cutaneous type all the way to the chronic discoid, chilblains LE, neonatal LE, et cetera. So again, I would strongly encourage you to bone up on all of that. You can kind of lump some of these together. The acute form, neonatal, and the subacute form, these all histologically look pretty similar. The acute form, obviously, get the malar erythema in the face and the clinical pearls sparing the nasolabial fold, photodistribution. SCLE can give you the annular or psoriasiform process, and neonatal LE can clinically and histologically look almost identical to SCLE. The mother in that situation usually has active SLE, and then you get transplacental antibody her antinuclear antibody titers goes across the placenta and then causes the disease in the child, which usually goes away over the course of time, but those kids sometimes can get lupus later on. The histology of all of these looks pretty much the same. Superficial perivascular infiltrate, sometimes deep, but usually more superficial with vacuolar interface change and dyskeratotic keratinocytes. Drug-induced SCLE, again, this most common causes, hydrochlorothiazide, the ACE inhibitors, calcium channel blockers, there's some others. This may or may not go away after you stop the drug. It may be photoexacerbated. It's often Rho positive. And there's one pearl with immunofluorescence. Sometimes you can see IgG punctate staining of the basilar keratinocytes on a DIF with this condition. Don't see it all the time, but if you see it, it's kind of a clue that might be helpful. So here's the malar rash of acute lupus. Notice the sparing of the nasolabial fold, the classic photodistributed butterfly distribution here. This is SCLE, the annular lesions. And, you know, we get these diagnosed, sent to us, ruatinia, things of that nature. So again, you should be aware of this diagnosis. Here's the histology. It shows usually a relatively sparse superficial perivascular infiltrative lymphocytes with vacuolar alteration of the dermoepithelial junction. And this can look very, very similar, we'll talk about this a little bit later, to dermatomyositis. So if you're trying to biopsy to distinguish between this disease and dermatomyositis, a skin biopsy is not the best way to go. I'll hit on that again in a minute, but just realize that histology, these can look very similar. There's some thinning of the epidermis, but there's really there's no markedly thickened basement membrane zone here, like you see with discoid LE, but there's this vacuolar alteration, and you may get some scattered dyskeratotic keratinocytes. You may get a significant amount of mucin in the dermis, but you don't have to. You don't have to get a single molecule of mucin in the dermis for lupus. If it's present, great, but you don't have to see it. And this is usually a pretty acute process. These people are usually pretty sick. They've been out in the sun, flares up, and basically you biopsy and it shows those findings. Now, the lupus band test, okay, we'll talk about this briefly. Basically, if you get a positive result here, usually get a granular deposition, it's kind of a diffuse coarse granular deposition of two or more immunoreactive D junctions, usually C3 and IgG. Ideally, you'd like to see all of them. And you see this in sun-protected non-lesional skin. It may correlate with the disease severity and ANA status. But I can tell you, I've seen lots and lots of biopsies of this in patients that have known lupus, and it's negative. So I don't like this test. It's not as good as doing serology. Serology is a lot better. If you actually want to get a positive biopsy skin that's in is lesional skin, but even there it may be negative. So I just don't like immunofluorescence for lupus. Usually by the time it's positive, it's pretty obvious clinically and histologically, and you really don't need it. So it doesn't very commonly rescue you. In fact, if anything, sometimes it can be a confusing situation. Somebody that you think may have rosacea, for example, versus lupus, you biopsy it, and it's really rosacea, and maybe has one immunoreactant that's deposited, and it's a little bit weak, and somebody calls it positive, and the person gets branded with lupus, and they really don't have it. If you do have a positive, this is what it looks like. It's usually a bright, thick, diffuse, coarse granular band. And if it's ideally, we like to see IgG, C3, IgA, IgM, everything, fibrinogen. We like to see everything positive. But by the time you see that, usually you don't need it for immunofluorescence. Discoid LE, again, you all know what the clinical manifestations of these are. Infiltrated discoid plaques, follicular plugging, ears, scalp, often African-American patients. You may get oral involvement, relatively uncommon. It's may or may not be associated with lupus. The vast majority of these obviously are not. The histology classically is a superficial and deep infiltrate with lymphocytes, vacuolar alteration of the ejection with thickening of the basement membrane zone, thinning of the epidermis with follicular plugging. In this condition, you often do get interstitial mucin, but you don't have to see it. So that's in discoid LE. These are some classic examples clinically of discoid LE. On the scalp, here you see the nice example of the follicular plugging, so-called carpet tack type scale here. So this is chronic discoid LE. And again, the histology, I just basically described it to you. And this is a classic example. So a low magnification, you can see it's got a superficial and deep infiltrate of lymphocytes. It's got involvement of the DE junction. It's going to have thickening of the basement membrane zone. And this one doesn't have as much follicular plugging as some have. It is on the face, but you'll often see follicular plugging. Notice the vacuolar alteration and involving the DE junction. And then you've got some thickening of the basement membrane zone around the edge of this hair follicle here. So that's a pretty classic example of discoid LE. Another area, this is a markedly thickened basement membrane zone here with thinning of the overlying epidermis. Okay, so that's discoid LE. A tumid LE, here it's a variant where you get mostly a dermal-based inflammatory reaction. So you get these indurated papules, plaques, nodules, less epidermal involvement. In fact, there may be no epidermal involvement, there'd be no scale, no follicular plugging. And basically this looks like one of the lymphocytic infiltrates, but it has mucin. And the direct immunofluorescence here usually is negative. So here's a couple of examples. Again, back in the old days when people used to use the diagnosis of Yesner's lymphocytic infiltrate a lot, Yesner's is probably a wastebasket term of several different entities, including polymorphous light eruption, including this entity, including gyrate erythemas. So it's probably one of several things. So if you see somebody that's got these sort of succulent nodules on their sun-exposed area, you see this has got some little patulous ostea here, so you may have actually had a couple little follicular plugs here. And this is a more classic example. This is the V of the neck, obviously, in a sun-exposed area. Sometimes you biopsy this and it shows massive amounts of mucin, and that is when we use the term reticular erythematous mucinosis, REM, which is probably a variant of this condition of tumid lupus. So here's the biopsy. It looks pretty similar to the discoid case we showed you before, but there's no epidermal involvement here. So no thickening of the basement membrane zone, no vacuolar alteration. This does have quite a bit of mucin in the dermis here. So lymphocytic infiltrate with mucin, you instantly think of your 5-6L differential diagnosis for lymphocytic infiltrates. If it's got mucin, you want to think of this diagnosis here. So think of the diagnosis of tumid LE or REM when you have mucin, and you can see that here, this bluish gray material in the collagen bundles, plus the lymphocytic infiltrate. Okay, bullous lupus. Now we talked a little bit about this last week when we talked about the blistering diseases. This gives you a subepidermal blister with neutrophil, similar to DH or linear IgA bullous dermatosis. If you do immunofluorescence studies here, again, you're gonna see that same pattern that we would like to see in a classic form with a linear or granular deposition of multiple immunoreactants. You can see bullous lesions in all forms of cutaneous lupus erythematosus, even in discoid LE sometimes, but it's most common in patients who have acute LE. They maybe they go off their prednisone, they go out in the sun, and they get a massive flare. Rowell syndrome, remember that entity? Lupus in patients with erythematoformis. So it's kind of a combination of EM and lupus. So here's an example. This patient's got these erosive lesions on the back of their hands, area they went out and got sun exposure. And the biopsy showed this subepidermal blister with all these neutrophils. And this was an example of bullous LE. So if you just saw this alone without any immunofluorescence, without any other information, you wouldn't be able to tell for sure that it wasn't an example of DH or linear IgA bullous dermatosis. If you see eosinophils infiltrate, you can sometimes get an occasional eosinophil or two in lupus, but it's rarer than those other conditions. So you'll see it more commonly in those. That's just a clue. At the end of the day, you really would need immunofluorescence to distinguish between the two. Here's an example off to the side. Neutrophils lining up with the basal cell layer here with some scattered individually necrotic keratinocytes. That's actually would be a good clue to this diagnosis versus LIGA or DH, where you usually don't get dyskeratotic keratinocytes. So again, if you were to see that, that would tend to favor the diagnosis. And here, this blister does show the diffuse coarse granular deposition of, I think this was IgG in this case. Okay, so those are lupus. Now, I didn't include lupus profundus. I think what we'll do is maybe have a talk on paniculitis in the next week or so, and I'll show you an example of that. And it shows primarily a lobular, mostly paniculitis with massive mummification and degeneration of fat with this hyaline degeneration with sometimes overlying lupus in the skin. But we'll show you that in the talk with you on paniculitis. Now let's move to dermatomyositis. Again, inflammatory myopathy with cutaneous lesions, but sometimes can be amyopathic. There's two different peaks, the childhood form and then the adult form when it's seen in older individuals. The adult, older group, you always want to make sure that they don't have malignancy. And the skin findings may precede the muscular weakness sometimes by years. And it's proximal muscle weakness. There are a number of different antibodies associated with this now that I highly recommend that you know. There's some new antibodies associated with the vasculitis, the variant of dermatomyositis associated with vasculitis. So make sure you know all of those different subtypes of dermatomyositis. There are a number of different cutaneous lesions, the heliotrope rash, Gottfried's papule, Gottfried's sign, which is different than Gottfried's papule, which are the atrophic plaques with pigmentary alteration, telangiectasia, and poikiloderma, periungual telangiectasia, the scalp dermatitis, the flagellator erythema. This is the heliotrope, the periorbital pink macular erythema around the eyes, and notice this little girl also around the mouth here, and this is the heliotrope flower, which looks pretty similar in color. The shawl sign, involving the posterior shoulders, the neck, the V sign of the chest, very common manifestation of that. The outer areas of the arm. This lady had the massive edema around her eyelids, giving these little bulli that developed. And these are really, when you biopsy these, it shows massive mucin deposition in the dermis when they get that. The scalp, commonly involved with dermatomyositis. And then the mechanics hands, bilateral symmetrical fissure areas, looks a lot like dyshidrotic dermatitis or acral psoriasis. So remember, if you see somebody that's got what looks like chronic dyshidrotic dermatitis or psoriasis and they're not responding, think about that as a diagnosis. Periungual telangiectasia with a little crusting here, classic. Notice the involvement directly over the knuckles with dermatomyositis. Lupus tends to involve the skin between the knuckles. So dermatomyositis is direct, D, directly over the knuckles, and lupus is between the knuckles. Poikilodermatomyositis, so dermatomyositis may coexist with some other clinical manifestations. You get poikiloderma, and then it's called poikilodermatomyositis. Sometimes it can be associated with scleroderma, sclerotic changes. Then we call it sclerodermatomyositis in that situation. You can get calcinosis cutis. You can see it both in the childhood form, where they get calcinosis and vasculitis, or these large sort of these massive areas of calcification. Here you see it on an x-ray in this adult that had calcinosis cutis associated with their dermatomyositis. So depending on which lesion you biopsy, you can show different manifestations. You can see epidermal atrophy with vacuolar alteration, very sparse infiltrate, may or may not get mucin. And as opposed to lupus, where you can get positive immunofluorescence, In dermatomyositis, it's usually negative. Now, the textbooks say you can sometimes see some IgM deposited and some IgM on cytoid bodies, but it's pretty nonspecific and it's not very helpful. And it's not something you look at the immunofluorescence and say, ah, that's dermatomyositis. It's really seen in association with clinical and histology. So it's not super helpful. Here you see a biopsy of dermatomyositis. This patient had known dermatomyositis. The biopsy was done. It looked like this. It shows features that look very similar, if not identical, to that case of early lupus that I showed you before. Superficial perivascular dermatitis with vacuolar alteration of the dermatodermal junction. So again, you can't really tell this from lupus. So we talk about biopsy not being super helpful. It's not super helpful. So it's better to do serology, look for muscle enzyme elevations, clinical evaluation, correlate those two together in order to make a diagnosis. So if you just do a blind biopsy of dermatomyositis and lupus and expect to be able to tell the difference, you're not going to be able to do it in many cases. That's why rheumatologists, it's sometimes frustrating for them because they want us to do a biopsy and tell them whether the patient has lupus or dermatomyositis. And we usually sort of say, I'm sorry, you have to go back to the patient and do serology and other clinical evaluation because it's the biopsy is not the best way to tell them apart. If you biopsy a Gottfried's papule, now you would think just by looking at these that you should see a lot of changes. And histologically, you see almost nothing. And this is repeated, it's in the literature. So it's almost a diagnosis of exclusion when you biopsy this. So you may see almost no inflammation. You see a little bit of interface change with some smudging, direct immunofluorescence, usually negative. So again, this is a kiddo, got pretty classic Gottfried's papules here. You would say, gosh, we biopsy one of those. Here's another person with classic dermatomyositis with a tendon streaking, beautiful example of that. So you biopsy and say, wow, you should expect to see a lot of inflammation there. Well, you don't. You sometimes see almost no inflammation. You see this kind of change, dilated blood vessels, sparse infiltrated dermis, a little smudging at the junctions. You can say that, well, there's something abnormal about this that's kind of got some smudging around these blood vessels here and maybe a little bit of smudging at the dermatodermal junction, but it's pretty nonspecific. And you have to have this in the combination of a clinical impression of a Gottfried's papule to make this diagnosis, or you just call it telangiectasia. Wouldn't call it anything. So you have to know what this looks like to make the diagnosis. I don't think the board is going to show you this because it's kind of too subtle. But just so you'll know from a clinical perspective, if you take a biopsy of this, it's not going to be a slam dunk. It's not going to really help you very much. So these conditions under the microscope and look a lot alike. Histologically look alike, like clinically, Gottfried's papule shows almost nothing. So just remember that a skin biopsy is not really the best way to go here. If you biopsy an acral lesion of lupus, again, it can look a lot like dermatomyositis, but the inflammation is usually seen between the knuckles, not directly on it. And this is going to be more likely to be positive in lupus than it is in dermatomyositis, but nevertheless, they're both likely to be negative. So this person had lupus, and notice that the inflammation is here between the knuckles. So spares the skin directly over the joints in lupus. So that's a helpful clinical pearl. And here's a biopsy of one of those, and you just can't tell it apart from dermatomyositis. Looks pretty much the same. So just remember that those two disorders can look pretty similar. So let's switch over and talk a little bit about Behçet's disease. This is a systemic disorder, recurrent acute inflammation. They get oral acne, genital ulcers, uveitis, skin lesions. So there are about 25 different clinical criteria they use on a clinical basis to make the diagnosis of Behçet's disease. This is one of the disorders where you can get pustular vasculitis. They can get an erythema nodosum-like inflammation. It's not really truly perfect erythema nodosum. It's a little bit different. They can also get sweets, but it's probably not classic sweets. It's probably more kind of a neutrophilic dermatosis. So the literature talks about these things, but it's really probably the neutrophilic dermatosis that's associated with Behçet's that's giving you this rather than these classic neutrophilic dermatoses. Systemic lesions, they can get uveitis. They can get neovascular lesions, glaucoma. You get a non-erosive arthritis. You can get vascular disease, cardiac disease, GI disease, so all sorts of abnormalities with Behçet's disease, neurologic disease, very common here. And the classic clinical way to make the diagnosis are the oral apthy plus two of these other lesions. You're supposed to exclude other things like writers, inflammatory bowel disease, bowel-associated dermatitis, arthritis syndrome. So you exclude those to make the diagnosis of Behçet's. So these are some of the apthae that you see with Behçet's. And usually these aren't one or two lesions that come and go. They usually come and stay. And if you actually biopsy these, you can usually, if you cut step sections, look hard enough and get deep enough, usually you can see evidence of some vasculitis in these. So this isn't just like a typical aphthous ulcer. They actually get some vascular involvement. Behçet's, you can get pustules in the skin, and this is one of the diseases where you get pathergy. So if you actually take a needle or traumatize the skin, they can actually develop a pustule at the site in Behçet's disease. So this is sterile pustule. If you culture that, obviously it's going to be negative. This is an example of one of those little pustules you see with Behçet's disease before they ulcerate, and it's basically a sterile neutrophilic infiltrate involving a pustule within ruptures. And this can ultimately then get larger and can lead to an ulcer. And you see the same sort of thing in early pyoderma gangrenosum. You get it initially, you get a little pustule, but then they rupture and they coalesce, you get this cribriform ulceration that forms. This is the aphthous ulcer of Behçet's. Looks pretty much like an aphthous ulcer that's not associated with Behçet's, so you can't tell those apart unless you get a deep involvement, and you can see evidence of some involvement around a blood vessel in some cases. But you have to get a really deep biopsy to see that it's not commonly seen. Okay, rheumatoid nodule, another disorder associated with connective tissue disease, obviously associated with rheumatoid arthritis. It's a deep palisaded granulomatous dermatitis with fibrin in the center of the palisade. Sometimes you can get some neutrophils associated with it. So this is an individual that had a rheumatoid arthritis and got all these nodules around their fingers. Probably one of the most common locations is on the elbow, like you see over here. And this is a nice biopsy. You generally need to get a deep incisional biopsy of rheumatoid arthritis. And you see the palisaded granuloma here with fibrin in the center of the palisade. This pink hyalinized material is fibrin. And here you see it here, high magnification surrounded by these histiocytes. So this is a classic example of rheumatoid nodule. And this one's actually got a few neutrophils associated with it as well. So that's a rheumatoid nodule. Subcutaneous GA can look pretty similar clinically. Histologically, you do not get the fibrin. Usually there, you'll just get mostly mucin in the center of the palisade. Sometimes you can get a little bit of fibrin, but usually not to the same degree. And then bowel-associated dermatosis arthritis syndrome, or bowel bypass syndrome, associated with patients that have had some type of a bowel procedure. It can be either a blind loop that gets created, sometimes they use, or it can sometimes be even just they cut out some of their bowel. They can still get this on some occasions. And it's associated with circulating antibodies. They have these antigen antibody complexes they deposit in the skin, causing a neutrophil-rich inflammatory reaction. They can get all sorts of skin lesions, papules, vesicles, pustules, everything into nodosum-like lesions. They can get fever. And if you biopsy this, it gives you a dense, diffuse infiltrate of abundant neutrophils. So it looks pretty similar to sweets, pyoderma gangrenosum. They histologically all look pretty much the same. And here you see an example of this. It's diffuse neutrophilic infiltrate. This one goes all the way down, involving the area around the blood vessel there in the subcutaneous fat. So virtually all of these cells are neutrophils, as you can see here. And then if you look at the bottom of that lesion, you would have seen the same involvement down there in the fat around that the blood vessels as well. It doesn't give you much of a true vasculitis, but it gives you kind of a perivascular infiltrate of neutrophils also. Occasionally, you'll biopsy somebody that's got a connective tissue disease. They get something that kind of looks like GA histologically, but it's not really GA. It's this palisaded granulomatous dermatitis that's associated with connective tissue disease. It can be associated with lupus, but also with rheumatoid arthritis, with Wegener's. So rather than, we used to call it palisaded granulomatous derm associated with lupus, but now we know it's not confined to lupus. It can be seen with rheumatoid arthritis, with other diseases as well. So if you see this, you need to work the patient up and find out what the connective tissue disease is that they have. You get this diffuse palisaded granulomatous dermatitis with histiocytes, but you also get neutrophils in this. And sometimes you can actually get some vasculitis, leukocytoclastic vasculitis. So here this patient's got one of these lesions here, maybe a lesion over here also. Here's another example. And this is actually one, there's one manifestation of this condition that's unusual. We can sometimes see a linear band, a rope in the skin, if you will, in association with this condition. In the biopsy, it looks the same as you see here. So you can see that there's this palisaded histiocytic infiltrate here, low magnification. Again, these are histiocytes and neutrophils in a palisade. There's some degeneration of collagen that's pretty characteristic here. You get leukocyte aplasia and this cariorexis. You don't have to see any vasculitis. Sometimes you can, but you very commonly see this neutrophilic infiltrate coupled with histiocytes in this palisaded pattern here. And in the old days, this also was called, Dr. Winkleman years ago was one of the first guys to describe this. They call it a Churg-Strauss granuloma because it was associated with Wegener's and Churg-Strauss disease. And they actually would also call it a Wegener's granuloma, Winkleman granuloma, because it's associated. Winkleman is one of the guys that originally described at the Mayo Clinic. So gives you this palisaded granulomatous pattern with histiocytes and also with polys. Here's another example. Notice the degenerated collagen here. Beautiful example of that condition. So the last thing we'll just touch about briefly are the autoinflammatory conditions. These are caused by an aberrant innate immune response mediated through interleukin-1 pathways. There's a cytoplasmic protein complex is associated with the inflammatory cascade, leads to release and production of this interleukin-1 beta. There are mutations in genes associated with these. They all, in common, have an inflammatory infiltrate with neutrophils that predominate. And clinically, they can have things that look like morbilliform eruptions or Cockerell eruptions, sterile abscess disease, pyometabolism, arthritis. So this is due to an abnormal inflammatory process resulting in neutrophils. They usually don't get granulomatous inflammation. And these, there's a whole list of these in the literature. So I don't think the board's going to expect you to know all of these, but you should know the general principles of these. And some of the ones they very well might ask you about, this hyper-IgD has been in the literature fairly recently. The familial Mediterranean fever, I think they expect us to know that. PAPA, SAFO, those that are associated with sterile abscesses and the arthritis, and also associated with acneiform lesions. So that's in the differential diagnosis of cystic acne and the acneiform processes. So I would recommend knowing about some of the major ones of these. Just an example, one of these that was kind of interesting, this neonatal onset multi-systemic inflammatory disorder, NOMID. So it's one of these, they call these the cryopyrinopathies. These kids get fever, facial dysmorphism, neurologic abnormalities, joint disease with urticarial skin lesions. And you biopsy it, it gives you this diffuse infiltrate with abundant polys. So notice the arthritis here, sterile arthritis, this papular eruption, almost kind of a morbilliform eruption that tends to be fixed, not coming and going. You biopsy it, shows an infiltrate containing all these neutrophils in here. So just make sure that you know the general principles of these autoinflammatory disorders and that they generally tend to have abundant neutrophils in the infiltrate. So hopefully this is helpful to you, a good overview of these various entities. They're not generally that difficult to diagnose, just kind of understand the general principles. Diagnosing lupus versus dermatomyositis, for example, understand the limitations of immunofluorescence studies. Understand the limitations of the serologic studies being better than lupus band test and some of those things. There are a few other diseases in these, but these are the majority of all of these that I think you really need to know. So with that, we'll stop. This is Vail, Colorado in the summer. Unfortunately, I'm not sure we're going to be going back there this summer for our meeting, but maybe next year. So any questions anybody has, happy to post them on the chat room and I'll be happy.